The following is an ECC Studios production in association with Mart 16 Media. Welcome to the God Stop, where we stop and wait for God to take us wherever He wants us to go. I am Tershatha Jeffrey. Thank you guys so much for joining us once again. So this week we are going to be discussing, as usual, two lessons, the adult lesson and the cornerstone. And one thing that I picked out of both of the lessons is that both of them are talking about the fact that God is a healer and that God restores us. So tonight, if you're joining us on Twitter, you can follow us twitter.com/thegodstop or look for us at The God Stop. If you're speaking to us on Facebook, facebook.com/thegodstop. And if you're talking to us on Skype as well, you can use the hashtag tonight, God Restores, to talk to us. So like I was saying before, God restores. That's what we're going to be speaking about tonight. And there is something that I am so excited about. I was dancing about it backstage. We have officially launched the God Stop chat room. Can I get a woohoo from somebody? Yay! So this means that you guys can go to www.eastcare.org just as you normally do. And if you're there right now, you will have noticed that the chat room is there. That means that if you guys talk to me, we can have a conversation in live time. That is so awesome. I am so excited, and I hope that you guys are too. So feel free to tweet us, feel free to Facebook us, feel free to Skype us, but remember that when you go to the chat room, when you go to eastcarib.org, click the link that says live programming, and then you'll and then you will see the screen come up as well as the chat room. It should be on your left, if I'm not mistaken. So yes. So we'll get right into the lesson. Before we do that, I want to introduce the guests. Hi, lovely ladies.
Hi.
How are you guys doing?
Good.
So can you guys tell me your names, tell me where you go to school, and tell me something about yourself? I'll start with you.
Hi, my name is Kiona.
Hi.
I go to school at the best school in Barbados.
Which is?
Barbados, Seventh-day Adventist Secondary School. Something about myself.
Yes.
I am beautiful.
You are.
Thank you.
Yes, yes. Very good. Hi.
Hi, my name is Kayla. I also go to the Barbados, Seventh-day Adventist Secondary School. Uh-huh. And I like music.
You like music. Okay, cool beans. So we have a beautiful person and a musician. Awesome. So this is going to be a really exciting night. So like I said, if you guys are talking to us on Twitter, the hashtag is God Restores. If you have any questions, put them on Twitter, send them to us on Facebook, add us on Skype, we'll talk to you. And also, find the chat room. Let's talk to each other, peoples. We're going to go take a quick break, and then we come back, we'll get right into the cornerstone, so don't go anywhere.
Rekindle the passion.
Share the joy.
The laity in Barbados and Dominica will come alive this year, and in particular in the months of April and May.
Special evangelistic crusades in every church with an explosion of Holy Ghost preaching.
We are ready to meet the needs of
choices. We make them every day. Some are small and some are big. Left or right. Right or wrong. Lust or love. Gossip or truth. Deceit or honesty. Panic or prey. Worry or peace. Integrity or dishonesty. Your will or God's will. Who you are today, for good or bad, all comes down to the choices you have made along the way. The decisions we make affect our lives 10, 15, 20 years from now. A choice made today will affect our lives tomorrow. So choose wisely.
Good evening once again. Welcome back to the God's Top. And we are going to get right into the lesson. But before we do that, let's just bow our heads so that we can have a word of prayer. Dear God, we love you so much, and we're so glad that you love us, and we're so glad that although we sin and we do the things that we shouldn't, you still set aside a day for us to come and worship you and just think about you, and we're really excited about that, and we're really grateful. So bless us tonight. Give us your Holy Spirit's presence so that we can learn more about you individually and together, so that this will prepare us for heaven. We love you so much. Amen. Mm-hmm. All right, Kiona.
Yes.
And Kayla. All right, let's get right into the lesson. So for those of you who may not have studied the Cornerstone lesson, this week's lesson is about the man by the pool of Bethsaida that was blind. So Jesus was passing through his town, and he saw the man by the pool of Bethsaida. And Jesus asked the man a very interesting question. It could be seen as rhetorical. It could be seen as obvious. But Jesus asked him anyways. Jesus asked the man, "Do you want to be well?" Now, I think that's an interesting take on the situation, which Jesus always did. Jesus always had an interesting way of bringing things out. But my question to you guys is, why do you guys think that Jesus asked the man whether or not he wanted to be well?
I think that he asked because when you have a lifelong sickness, it's sometimes so, all of it is. I don't know. You just don't have hope that you could get better, and you're just so accustomed to being sick that you don't think that nobody can help you.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that sometimes when you have a sickness, you get so comfortable and accustomed to people doing everything for you. So, like, just wanted to give it all up doesn't seem worth it. So, you still have to ask.
Mm-hmm. So, I guess it's kind of like how I was thinking about it when I read the lesson was maybe Jesus, like you guys said, maybe Jesus wanted to know whether or not he really wanted to get well. Because there are people, and I'm sure all of us know people, and maybe we're you know, guilty of doing this sometimes ourselves, where we're in a bad situation or we're going through troubles. And instead of praying, instead of asking God to help us out of it, we kind of wallow in self-pity. We kind of wallow in this feeling, oh, I'm so, woe is me, and we have a pity party, and we're happy. It's my party. I can cry if I want to. So I think it made sense that Jesus would ask that question, because it's like he's making sure, and, you know, it's a lesson to all of us. Do you want to be well? You're going through exam struggles. You're going through a bad situation in your life right now. Do you want Jesus to help you out of that struggle? So this brings me to my next question. Do you think that present day Christians, us right now, do you think that sometimes we go through things where we just kind of, we'd prefer to go through it ourselves and be really like mad all the time than to give it to God and help, like let him take it over? Do we do that sometimes?
Yes, because teenagers don't really like want help. They want to find their own way, find out how to do the things themselves. So I think yes.
Yeah, I agree with Kayla. When you're going through something, you want it, all the negative, so you could be stronger, but you don't know that God, if you let him help you that, he can help you do that. So I think that would be the stronger thing than all.
It's true. And we just kind of want to be, I just kind of want to be sad right now. Please do not talk to me about God and happiness and joy. I just want to be sad. And you are raining on my already rainy parade. I don't like it. You know, we have those moments. I think we need to, like, get out of them. So I think that's what Jesus was showing us. This is for, you know, everything he did was so that we can have an example all these years later. But he was also showing the people around him that, you know, just because you're in a situation doesn't necessarily mean that you want to get out. So I think that was an interesting point that was raised. And so Jesus asked the man, do you want to be well? And, you know, the man said yes, and Jesus said, okay, your faith has made you well, or whatever, get up. Now, my question is, Jesus told the man, you want to get well? All right. And Jesus granted him that desire. How do you think Jesus would have reacted differently had the man said no? Which, as you guys have said before, sometimes we do that. Sometimes we're in a bad situation and God wants to help us and we're just like, I'm not even about taking your help right now, God. I just want to do this by myself. How do you think the story would have gone had the man said, well, not really, you know, because my mom, she still cooks me lunch like every day, you know? And technically the people from the village, I make like a dollar a day sitting here because they're really compassionate and stuff. How do you think the story would have gone if the man had said no?
I don't think that God would change his lifestyle to make it bad that he said no, but God just gives us a choice and that's what we choose to do. Mm-hmm. So I think that later on he would have butt up against something because I think that God was saving him from something that could have happened in the future.
I agree with Kiona because, like she said, God gives us a choice. Mm-hmm. So probably he would have like continued to let him go off the sickness for like longer, and then he probably would have met another circumstance when he would have like flashback and see that maybe he should have accepted that Jesus' help. So,
yeah. Well, the reason I asked that question is because I just want to show that God gives all of us free choice. He doesn't do anything that we don't want him to do. You know what I mean? And I think this can correlate to other circumstances in the Bible where Jesus, you know, the rich young ruler came to Jesus and said, what must I do to be saved? And Jesus said, well, sell all you have. You know, Jesus said, well, keep the commandments. And the man said, yeah, I'm good. Like, I do that. I go to church every Sabbath and I don't steal and I don't lie. I'm good. And then he said, okay, cool. Sell everything that you have and follow me. And the man was like, well, I really about that at this moment in my life. And Jesus let him go. Jesus didn't say, no, I'm gonna make you sell. Jesus like gave him that power of choice. So I think we have to remember that and we have to like think about that. Okay, so today, it was earlier this morning. I'm doing my thesis and I have to do something called SPSS. SPSS is like Excel on steroids. It's this thing or whatever. And I was going through something and I'm just like, I got so frustrated and I was so angry. And I'm like, Lord, listen to me. Like, I just can't do this. I don't want to do this. I was so, so, so mad. And like you guys were saying earlier, I just wanted to be in my little bubble of anger and frustration and I didn't want to hear anything else, you know? And my voice was just like, all right, just pray. And I'm like, I don't want to pray right now. I want to be mad. I want to be sad. I don't want to pray, you know? And I prayed and it was like, okay, cool. You know, I kind of had this peace or what have you. So, all right, in that situation, I prayed. What are some things that we can do when we get into this situation, when we get frustrated, we get angry, that reminds us that we need God's help? I want some practical tips from you guys about how to remember that we need God's help and that we shouldn't just wallow in self-pity all the time. So I can draw on them next time and not get mad.
Favorite Bible verse. Mm-hmm. I think that if you continue to read that, you just have some sort of assurance that God is there. You don't have to go through that alone.
Mm. What's your favorite Bible verse?
Psalm 46. Mm-hmm. God is my refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Mm.
Kayla?
Well, I agree with Kiona, but I think prayer is a good thing, and also to reflect on like examples in the Bible of people that they got so caught up in their like distress and like, they didn't really acknowledge God, but in the end he was like always brought them through. So like also to look back at circumstances in your life where you failed and to realize that God is always there for you. So sometimes you won't be in our bubble, but God is always there and he'll bring us through it.
Mm-hmm. You have a favorite Bible verse?
Yes, it is Philippians 4 verse 19. My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory through Christ Jesus. Mm.
So you said awesome favorite Bible verses. So you said, Kayla, you were saying, well, so think about someone in the Bible that has gone through something where they got really like, oh, can you give me an example?
Well, it's not really close, but Job, he had like a lot of stress to take on with his children being killed and his wife wanted him to curse God, and like he could have just decided to wallow himself in pity and do what his wife said to do, but he just praised God and at the end of it he was blessed more than he had before, and that was really awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think Joseph, because I mean living in a house with brothers that don't like you, that's really hard. And how much hate they used to bring on him. Mm-hmm. And to the point that they're trying to pay and still sold him. I mean, he could have given up. He didn't have to listen to God. Mm-hmm. But he did, and it turned out right for him.
Mm-hmm. True. Very, very true. And I think another thing that I picked up out of the story, which I think we may have touched about before, this man could not walk for 38 years. I have not even been alive for 38 years. Neither have you guys, because you guys are, you know, teenagers. So do you think sometimes that you're allowed to stay in that self-pity because you've been going through this long, for, you know, a long time? Can you say, well, you know, I can be sad, I can be mad, I can be depressed because I've been going through this, I've been praying about it. I'm sure that the man was praying about it. People prayed for him. I can hold on to this because I've had it for so long. You know what I mean? Do we have that freedom?
But if you are in a position where you have been down and sad for like a number of years, being angry or mad doesn't really fix the situation. It just makes you feel worse, and then you can end up hating other people and also hating yourself. So you should just be happy that everybody don't have everything. So even if you're in a bad circumstance, you can get out of it eventually.
True.
Mm-hmm. I think that everybody is accessible to having different feelings. You can feel mad and sad, but I think you have to know where and when, mm-hmm. because you can't let feelings dictate how your life can go. Mm. So.
True. Okay. All right, cool. So we have to take a break. We're going to come back and we're going to discuss the second part of this lesson. We're going to discuss the fact that Jesus healed a man on the Sabbath, and that a lot of people were not happy about that. So we're going to talk about that. So we're coming right back. Don't forget that if you're tweeting us, you can tweet us with the hashtag GodRestores. Look for us at The God Stop. You can Facebook us as well. So just facebook.com/TheGodStop. And you can Skype us as well. So just find us, look for The God Stop on Skype, and send us a request, and we'll add you. We always add people. And also, once again, reminding you guys, we have a new chat. So if you go to eastcarib.org, there is a link on the bottom left-hand corner that says click here to chat. You click the link and the chat will show up right next to the video, and you guys can chat and talk to us in live time. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with the rest of the Cornerstone lesson and Kiona and Kayla. We'll be right back.
The following informational message is brought to you by Sagebrush. If you want to live a life of integrity, please follow these special instructions. Admit when you are wrong. Be the first to forgive. Be the first to stand when everyone else sits down. Do what is right, even when no one else does. Say no when people are trying to get you to do something you know you shouldn't. Tell the truth and accept the consequences. Stand up for something you believe in, even though it might mean rejection or ridicule. Defend someone who is considered unpopular or unacceptable. When faced with a limitation, give your very best, regardless of pain or discomfort. Confront a fear without running away. Give sacrificially to protect or promote either someone you love, someone who has been wronged, or someone in need. If you follow these special instructions, you will be on track to live a life of integrity. Thank you for listening.
Welcome back to the God Stop.
Yes, welcome.
Look
back.
Who has joined us, Pastor Reed. Hi, Pastor Reed.
Yeah, I'm saying welcome back.
Pastor Reed just joined us. For those of you guys that were not with us, just joined us. It's all right, Pastor Reed. No problem. Anyways, so yes, I'm glad that you're here though, because I kind of felt not alone because I've got two gorgeous young ladies with me. It's just, you know, two heads are better than one. So I'm very glad that you're back.
That's so sweet.
Oh, I know. I'm made of sugar and spice. So we're getting right back into the content. And before we go into the second part of the Cornerstone lesson, we were speaking before, Pastor Reed, about how Jesus asked the man that he met by the pool of Bethesda whether he wanted to get well. And that's kind of, it's like an obvious question. Of course he wants to get well. He couldn't walk for 38 years. But we came to the realization that sometimes when you're going through something, you want to hold on to that anger. You want to hold on to that fear, to that pity. You want to have a pity party. You want to have to cry because you're used to it. But we came up with some tips, like remembering your favorite Bible verse and remembering a situation where God has brought you through before, or someone in the Bible that has gone through a similar situation. So you can dwell on that and you can give up that control to God. And Lou on Twitter said that sometimes we don't realize that we don't want the help because we're caught up doing our own thing. So I think that we have to stay focused on God, and we have to make sure that He is who we are looking at all times, so that we don't get caught up doing our own thing, like Lou said, and so that we can accept that help and get better. Because like you said, holding on to fear and doubt and stuff, it's not hurting anyone but ourselves, right? All right, so I'm coming to the second part of the lesson. Don't forget that you guys can chat with us, eastcarib.org, click on the link, bottom left-hand corner, and you guys can chat with us as well as Twitter and Facebook and Skype. And so the second part of the lesson. So Jesus healed the man. Now, Jesus was going around, he was walking around, he was probably like trying to get, you know, his Sabbath lunch digested. It was a Sabbath, and he was walking around and he saw the man and he healed the man. Now, the Pharisees, as usual, were up in arms because Jesus could not do anything right for the Pharisees. I'm sure they were like, hey, your robe is too long today. You know what I mean? Like, they always found something to nitpick about. So they were not happy that Jesus healed on the Sabbath, right? So my question is what's the Sabbath for? What is the purpose, or what are the purposes of the Sabbath?
I think the purpose of Sabbath is to draw you closer to God, give you a better understanding of what He wants to do for you. Mm-hmm. But, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right, I think since verse says that the Sabbath was made for man, so that I think it's time for God and man as to connect, to like reflect when God created the world. Mm-hmm. Science of bringing them closer together. That's what I think.
Okay. So Sabbath is for rest and fellowship. Is that all that Sabbath is for, though?
No, I don't think so. I think if you should help people, because I think there's a verse in the Bible that says that we should help one another or love one another just as we love ourselves. So if we see someone in need, doesn't matter what day of the week is, that we should try to help them.
Even if it's a Sabbath and you have to go to church and get there for 9:15,
yes,
you still do it?
Because if you are driving a car, mm-hmm, and the car breaks down, you are stalled on the road, and one of your friends passes you by, you're going to be like, you want them to stop. You want to like, you wouldn't want them to say, I have to get church for 9:15, so I'm going to leave you here. Mm-hmm. You would want them to help you. Mm-hmm. So I guess we should have that same feeling for other persons.
I agree with Kayla.
So we can do good, or we can do good things on the Sabbath. It's not just for being holy and pious and
sitting down in church. Can we go overboard and doing good on the Sabbath? Can you do too much good on the Sabbath? I mean, we have,
we have six days.
Mm-hmm. So don't you think that there are persons who neglect to do things that they can do during the week and just say, oh, it's the Sabbath, it's good to do good, so I'm going to do it today. I don't have to go to AY. I stay away from AY and go and visit somebody who's sick because it's good to do good on the Sabbath. Is that all right?
No, I guess you should balance it. Oh, you shouldn't procrastinate. So if there's something that you could have done during the 6 days, I don't think you should wait to the seventh day, the Sabbath, to do it. You should do it during the week.
Mm. Yeah. I mean, like, going and visit somebody, that's okay, that's great, but don't make it a reason to skip out on something.
Understood. That's important. Because even Jesus, he didn't let anything necessarily interrupt him from even going to the synagogue. He would have met people on the way. He did what he had to do. He helped them, but he continued going to the synagogue. Mm.
Okay. So what I'm hearing you guys say is, not only don't use doing good on the Sabbath as an excuse, but I think I would like to add also, The thought slipped my mind. Pastor, take over the thought. Like, no, it literally. Sorry. I have these moments. But yes, not only should we not use the Sabbath like as an excuse to, you know, just you not use doing good as an excuse to not go to church, or Pastor Reed's, the thorn in his side is not people not going to AY, but we also, yes, your side, but we also should not just say, well, it's Thursday, so let me, I'm going to go visit people in the nursing homes on Sabbath because, you know, I'm going to be doing a good thing or whatever. I think that we should, the good things that we do on Sabbath, reaching out to the community, going into the community and talking to people and doing outreach and stuff like that, I think that we should extend that to the week as well. you know, because Jesus didn't just heal people on the Sabbath. He also healed people on other days of the week as well. So then what, looking at the whole lesson, looking at the beginning, what we spoke about in the first segment, as well as right now, just your final thoughts about the lesson, about everything together, or about one aspect, just before we have to go.
I think that, to me, it says that God gives us a choice, and that,
God gives us a choice,
Well, I think that God uses our circumstances to bring us closer to Him, and that we shouldn't wall ourselves in self-pity, that we should just wait for God to give us the right answer, and that to give Him control of our anger and our pity.
True. God is always here.
Yes, He is. So He's always there. Two awesome final comments from two awesome, lovely ladies. So we are going to take a quick break, and we'll come back with Eye of Praise. So don't go anywhere. Thank you so much, Kiona and Kayla, for joining us. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Pastor Jason Reed.
And I'm Kishatha Jeffrey, and we're the hosts of a show called The God Stop that airs on the East Caribbean Conference's website every Friday night at 7 p.m.
The Bible tells us in Galatians chapter 6 and verse 2 that we are to bear one another's burdens. And today we come with a very special initiative to help our brother bear his burden.
We're coming to you on behalf of Naomi, Kirk Applewhite's daughter, who is experiencing a kidney condition called vasicoureteral kidney reflux disease. It is characterized by the formation of cysts on her kidneys, as well as the flow of urine from her bladder to her kidneys is reversed. The condition is very uncomfortable, and it's something that I believe no child should ever have to live with.
We're here to ask you, yes, to offer your prayers on behalf of this little girl and the family, but we're also asking you to make some financial contributions because there is a financial burden.
All in all, the cost for the surgery, as well as miscellaneous things such as accommodation, airfare, etc., comes to $40,000. The family is in dire need of funds in order to make sure that little Naomi gets better. So, in order to find out more about little Naomi, her family, and her condition, you can visit the website at www.facebook.com/TheNaomiProject, or you can search for The Naomi Project on Facebook to find out how you can help.
The clock is ticking. We hear you.
Oh my, oh my.
We see you.
Welcome back to the God Stop once again. We have come to our segment, I Praise, where we'll be blessed with an item of special music by Jewel Brewster, doing His Strength is Perfect.
Yeah, welcome back. You would have enjoyed that nice, what do you call it? You blow the, what do you call it?
It's a flute pastry, and people that play the flute are called flautists. I play the violin. Flautists.
You play the violin. I play the violin.
Violinist. Mm-hmm. You're a, he's a pastorist.
You go to break at this thing.
Okay, we're done.
Yes, thank God for that.
God? Yeah, well, what do you mean? What do I mean? Who in this day and age believes in a God?
Well, I do. Why is that?
Obviously, you haven't noticed the wars, the destruction, poverty, everything that's going wrong in this world.
Yeah, well, I don't believe in dentists. We think about it. If there's such a thing as dentists, then why do so many people have broken, infected, and missing teeth?
I can't help but people are stupid enough not to come and see the dentist and get their teeth fixed up and their mouth fixed up.
Exactly, and that's the same way with God. He can't help anyone who doesn't come to him if they insist on doing things their own way.
Choices. We make them every day. Some are small and some are big. Left or right. Right or wrong. Lust or love. Gossip or truth. Deceit or honesty. Panic or prey. Worry or peace. Integrity or dishonesty. Your will or God's will. Who you are today for good or bad all comes down to the choices you have made along the way. The decisions we make affect our lives 10, 15, 20 years from now. A choice made today will affect our lives tomorrow. So choose wisely.
Good evening. Welcome back to the God Stop. Thanks for joining us. So we did the Cornerstone lesson earlier, and that was really interesting. And so the chat room that is online, if you guys want to join, www.eastcarib.org, scroll down to the bottom left-hand side of the page, and you'll see a link that says click here if you want to chat. So just click and join us in the chat. So in the chat room just now, I thought it was really interesting because there are some people, and they're speaking about the Cornerstone lesson in terms of how Jesus did good on the Sabbath. And I think that to a certain extent, I would like Pastor you to clear some things up, because I saw a lot of things that spoke about Jesus working on the Sabbath. And I think it was not that Jesus was working. He was not, I don't know. I guess maybe you could put this better since you're a pastorist and I'm not. But, you know, you're a pastorist, like Joel's a flautist. I'm rolling with it. Anyways, so I think, you know, we just make that distinction for me between the fact that Jesus did good on the Sabbath, what he did, he was doing good deeds, and between how some people would say that Jesus worked on the Sabbath.
Well, Jesus, I don't think you can determine and say that he worked on the Sabbath. If you're doing good deeds, I mean, giving somebody a lift or doing something good for somebody, if you want to consider that as labor, I think you're stretching it a bit too far. If it's not like Jesus was building benches or whatever, or houses on the Sabbath, he was actually doing good. He met people on the way, they were in a need, and he assisted them. He helped them out of that need, regardless of what day it was. And that cannot be considered as labor. He wasn't being paid for it. Mm-hmm. He was just doing something out of his kindness, out of his love as Jesus. I mean, God is a God of love. And he cannot pass someone in need and not help them. Mm-hmm. It's not about money. It's not about labor. Mm-hmm. So it's a great distinction mm-hmm. between labor and actually acts of kindness and doing good. What he did was really acts of kindness. Mm.
Okay, so I hope that all of you guys that are on the chat room currently that were having that discussion, I hope that that kind of clears things up for you. It cleared things up for me, so hopefully it did. Okay, so we're going to get right into the adult lesson, and we have two new lovely ladies. Sorry, Pastor Reed, but tonight is the night of the girls. Hi, guys.
Hi
y'all. So introduce yourselves for me, please? Tell me your name. Tell me something awesome about yourselves. It has to be awesome.
My name is Kimberly DeMandanza. I am from the Breath of Life SDA Church. Mm-hmm. Something awesome. Okay. I love to do sign language. I think that's awesome.
It is. It is. You watched a lot share a few weeks ago where Rika Lynn and Shari spoke about sign language.
Oh no.
You should watch it. It was really awesome.
Okay.
Hi. Hi, I'm Adrian Bellamy. I go to Grisette Church and something awesome. Being me is awesome, but I want to be a nurse, a midwife, so I think that's awesome.
A midwife? Yeah. Oh, interesting. Okay, cool beans. So we have two awesome people in our awesome set. Such awesomeness. Okay.
And we have a pretty, I don't want to necessarily call it awesome in terms of the lesson. I think it is a kind of sobering lesson, this one, as it relates to Joel, a holy God, a holy, a just God, and so on. Mm-hmm. I think it's very sobering, as I said, and as you would have looked and studied the lesson for the week, as we're looking at Joel, which opens with a very horrible or horrifying scene, mm-hmm. one of severe devastation. And as you listen to the imagery and the words that he would have used as a linguist, I guess you would have been able to look at it a kind of way and understood what he was coming from, where he described a situation where he said a locust will come, they will eat this, and whatever they left back, some other thing will eat, and whatever that left back, some other thing would eat it, and whatever that left back, the caterpillar would eat it, and it seems like everything will just be gone. It was a scene of tremendous horror.
Desolation.
Mm-hmm. And a scene that is compared to, you listen to him, it's likened to the great day of the Lord. And what do you understand by that in terms of the great day of the Lord?
I think it's talking about God's judgment mm-hmm. on this entire earth, because it has to happen and it will happen at some point in time. Just like how you said, so many things happened mm-hmm. back in Joel's time. I think the day of the Lord has to do with when he comes back. There's going to be judgment. There are going to be those who, yes, are going to receive his blessings, and there are going to be those who don't. Mm. So that is, and it will happen.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's also the day of judgment where everything will finally come to end. God will finally put everything to end, and his will and his plan will finally be carried out to the length it's supposed to be done to.
And I like the memory text. I like to hold the book, so the management may be upset. The Lord thunders at the head of his army. Mm-hmm. His forces are beyond number, and mighty are those who obey his command. The day of the Lord is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure? Mm-hmm. I mean, and it is saying that what is painted here in Joel is actually not in totality a correct comparison with the day of the Lord. Actually, the day of the Lord is going to be worse. Mm. Now, what you're saying in Joel, how do you really relate to that, TJ? I mean, he says it's going to be worse.
Be ready. Mm-hmm. Like, you need, you know, for myself, like, I need to make sure that I'm right with God, because if talking about, first of all, I don't like bugs. And bugs are going to be eating things, and mm-hmm. there's going to be so much stuff happening, so much craziness. I think the only way we can look at that and not be like scared or fearful or want to run around like screaming like chickens with our head cut off is if we're ready and if we have that relationship with God. I think that's the only thing.
And as you look at it, and which is true, I mean, it's a scary scene. And we are saying that the lesson starts by, is entitled A Holy, A Just God. Mm-hmm. How can you see a holy and just God in the midst of what Joel has described in the first part of the book about this terrible scene, and it's all linked to God, God? How can God be holy and just with this type of dreadfulness?
I think when you just look at the description, how it says, it shows a God like fire and brimstone just coming down on everybody. But I guess when you really look and see what the end result, when he says that those who are just, he will vindicate, and those who are evil, their punch will be done. I guess when you look at it from that sense, on that part, you can see how he's just unholy. But when you're just looking at the part with everything being destroyed, this happening, that happening, you're not going to really see how that could be just and holy and good.
I think God is really patient with us because it doesn't just say, God didn't just decide, okay, I know these people are going to be wicked, so let me just get rid of them one time and save myself the stress. Because as human beings, well, I would do that. As human being, yeah. Like, why allow people to have a chance over and over and over? And that's what makes God just. He constantly gives a chance over and over again. So when his judgment comes, there's nobody that can say that God is not just. There's nobody that can say God did not give them the ultimate amount of chances that they could possibly have, right? So I think that God is definitely just.
That's true. Go ahead.
Well, I think that, you know, Adrian was saying that when we look at the end result, but I think even before, you know, we look at the end result or in conjunction with looking at the end result, we can look at why God made this. This was not like God just got up, or, you know, not he got up, God doesn't sleep, but God just decided, well, you know, I just have nothing better to do and I'm just going to send locusts and caterpillars and cankerworms. The Israelites had a history of consistently not paying attention to the things that God wanted them to do. So they already had a history. They already had a background of just doing the wrong thing. And like Kimberly said, God had given them time upon chance to get it together. And it was like they couldn't. So God was like, okay, I'm going to need to teach you guys a lesson. I'm going to need to show you guys what your life is like without me, without my guidance. And I think that, like you said, the Israelites could not say God is not being just right now because they had to think, no, but we're not paying attention to what God wants us to do. We're not following his precepts and his commands. And that God was justified in what he's doing. It's not for us to justify anything that God does ever. You know, I'm not saying that at all. Yet we can see that God had given them chance and they were not paying attention. And sometimes we're humans. Sometimes we don't learn because somebody has told us. Sometimes we learn because we go through something and we get hurt or whatever. And sometimes that's how we have to learn. So that's how I look at it.
Understood. And that's good. I mean, it's a sad thing that we have to go through the fire to be burned. But and in the midst of that, we are seeing Joel calling the persons to the people to repentance. Mm-hmm. But he's not just calling them to an ordinary repentance. He's saying, come with mournfulness. You have to come with mourning, fasting. All these things you have to come in terms of your repentance. Are all these things necessary? I mean, can you just say sorry and move on? Why is he calling? Why does he mention all of these things? I mean, you have to be mourning, you have to fast. Is that necessary?
I don't think so. Because just saying sorry, anybody could say sorry. I mean, it's just a word. You could just say sorry. It doesn't have to have any meaning. But I guess you wanted them because it's honesty and sincerity. Because if you're not honest and sincere about what you have done to be repent for, it doesn't make any sense and it doesn't mean anything to God because, as everyone knows, he knows everything. So even when you go to him, he knows if you're sincere or not, if you're sorry for what you did or not. So I guess that's why he was insisting on them those things that they had to do so that they would really be sincere and repentful.
Yeah, he was calling them to that wholehearted. And before we go to a quick break and come back, but let's just read this in terms of that repent. I like this. This sounded nice.
You would never think that.
It says, we must know our real condition, or we shall not feel our need of Christ's help. We must understand our danger, or we shall not flee to the refuge. We must feel the pain of our wounds, or we should not desire healing. Mm-hmm. And we'll go to break, we'll come back, and we will discuss a little more of our lesson. I hope we have more time.
Yes, we do. We're coming back. We'll be right back.
The following informational message is brought to you by Sagebrush. If you want to live a life of integrity, please follow these special instructions. Admit when you are wrong. Be the first to forgive. Be the first to stand when everyone else sits down. Do what is right, even when no one else does. Say no when people are trying to get you to do something you know you shouldn't. Tell the truth and accept the consequences. Stand up for something you believe in, even though it might mean rejection or ridicule. Defend someone who is considered unpopular or unacceptable. When faced with a limitation, give your very best, regardless of pain or discomfort. Confront a fear without running away. Give sacrificially to protect or promote either someone you love someone who has been wronged, or someone in need. If you follow these special instructions, you will be on track to live a life of integrity. Thank you for listening.
Welcome back to the God Stop. Thanks for joining us. So before we get back into dealing with our panelists, there is a message on Facebook. And Stefan asked, he said he wants to know how the message that Joel gave to the Israelites, how that can be used for us today. In fact, I'm going to the panel with that question. Is the message that Joel gave to the people of Israel or to the children of Israel, is that relevant to us today?
Yeah, I believe so. Because he was telling them that to repent, to change their ways. And a lot of us, we may go through the motions. I had a point in time it was like that, go through the motions. But you're not there, in other words. I don't know how best to explain that. Mm-hmm. You're there at church, but you're not having that sincerity of heart. Mm-hmm. And that is why we have to, as you were saying before we went to break, that's why we have to go through all of these things so that we can like actually rend our hearts and turn towards God and say, Lord, I am sorry, I am a mess, and I need you to fix me. I need you to be there for me. And God always answers our prayer.
Always, yeah, mm-hmm. True.
I think it's for us today also, because as the Israelites we find, probably not in the same situation as the same things they we do. Well, probably yes, but we find ourselves in the same situation over and over and over again where we turn away from God, we do something, and we end up in some kind of mess. So we too need to apply that same thing to us when we go to God to repent and be sorrowful so that we, in turn, could be the persons He wants us to be and allow Him to work inside of us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it totally compares. And the thing is that as you look at it and you build on it, sometimes you may even want to say to yourself that the message is more for us than it was for them. Mm-hmm. Because as the comparison is made, it is saying that great day of the Lord is going to be even greater than what occurred here in Joel. Right. In terms of that executive judgment that God will perform when He comes, mm-hmm. that those who are just will be on one side, those who are unjust will be on the other side. And since we are living in the age, we don't know when that will happen. And it is saying to us that we need to be getting ourselves ready. Mm-hmm. And that is why we can use the whole idea how He called them to repentance. It is a call to us today as well. For us to be called to a religion, not of form and just tradition, but a religion that really makes sense, that a religion that really moves the heart. Because he was calling to a wholehearted repentance. And what Joel is saying to us today in 2013 is that you don't know when God is going to come. You don't know when you may die. So you need to really seek out your salvation with fear and trembling. You got to be serious about it. And that is the seriousness of this entire message of Joel. And that will take me to a text. There are two texts. Because in Joel, he's saying, if you call on the Lord, you'll be saved. And then there's a text in Matthew, which leads to the whole idea of being really serious with Christianity. Mm-hmm. Joel 2:32.
And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Israel shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call.
Right, and he says in that text, whosoever shall call in the name of the Lord shall be saved. Mm-hmm. And what follows repentance in Joel is an outpouring of the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. which tells us as a people, when we turn to God, what does He do?
He gives us the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's necessary.
Yeah.
It is. Because, I mean, having the Holy Spirit, when you look in the Bible, having the Holy Spirit is necessary for us to do the things that God wants us to do. We need to have the Spirit's presence. When we look at Jesus' ministry, Jesus was baptized and started His ministry. But what happened before He started His ministry? The Holy Spirit descended on Him like dove. So He had the Holy Spirit's presence. Then it talks about the fact that He was led into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit to be tempted of the devil. You understand? And all these things, then the disciples on the day of Pentecost, they were in that upper room for 10 days praying and trying to become in one accord before the Holy Spirit descended on them. And then they went out and they spoke, and people understood them no matter what language they spoke. And 3,000 people were saved and added to God's kingdom on that day. So it's like we need the Holy Spirit. But before that, we have to pray, we have to repent, we have to make sure that we ask for that connection with God, because it's necessary to be saved. It's necessary.
It's true, and that is very important. And the thing is that maybe the assurance is when we turn to God, despite how bad things are, how bad we would have been before, when we turn to Him, mm-hmm. Joel assures us that what will happen? He will turn to us. Huh?
Yes.
He will respond to us, and that is comforting.
Yeah.
No, you have that text to say, when you call in the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. What's the other text in Matthew 7:21?
Yes. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven.
Mm-hmm. So what do you understand in terms of these two texts? One is saying whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The other one is saying not everyone that calls. Mm-hmm. What did you get from that?
Seem to be contrasting, but really isn't. Mm-hmm. Because this one here says not everyone who said unto me, Lord, Lord, because there are some people that they just do things because of what others can see. But as you were saying before, the Lord knows your heart. So you can say, oh, Lord, yes, I go to church every week. I do this. I do that. But are you true within yourself? Are you being honest? Are you really worshiping God? Or as soon as you go through the door, you're like, glad that's over now. Let me go back to how it was before. So that's what these texts are really saying. Yes, if you call on God truly and sincerely, yes, then he will answer you. But not if you're just doing it out of, because, I should go to church, so this is what I'm going to do.
Honestly.
I agree, too, is about the sincerity and the wholeheartedness, because, yes, you can call on God's name. Anybody could call God's name. You could sit down and talk to God, but if you're not sincere and honest and really about it, it's like how people say that, or how you hear that your prayers will go to the roof and bounce back, or whatever they say. Right, so I believe that's what he's talking about. So even though Joel talks about calling on the Lord, it means that, well, yes, you can go and call on the Lord, but then in Matthew it says, it's trying to say, but when you come, you have to be sincere, wholehearted, in order for anything to happen.
Yeah, that's true.
God don't deal with fakers.
Nah. Yeah. But then when we call on the name of the Lord and we are sincere, God restores.
Yeah.
Like the hashtag today. God restores. God does. He gives us that. Because God doesn't want us to stay in our mess and to stay in our sadness and our despair and our self-pity and our horribleness and our sin. God wants us to call us out of that darkness into the marvelous light that He has set out for us. So once we call upon His name, He's just and He's faithful. And He does the things that He has promised that He would do when we come with Him sincerely.
So we take some final comments from you guys as we wrap up this segment.
One thing will be that, just even though you might find yourself in messes, or yes, you're not perfect, but we should always remember and know that God is always there, and He always gives us chances after chance, even though soon, or no one knows when, but that chance will be over. But we know now that we have it, so we should take advantage of it and not wait until it's too late to say, well, I should have known, or I should have done, or...
Wonderful.
I think that's a good message to leave with as well. God's arms are open wide to us all the time. And as I always tell myself, I'm not checking, in other words, for what other people do. I'm not checking for them. You have to check for yourself, in other words. You have to be able to say, well, Lord, I know that I'm this way, but I need your help. And when you are sincere, God always answers us. And I think that that's the message that I got from this entire lesson. God always answers us when we are sincere.
Yeah, wonderful.
And I was just saying that, we just have to remember that God is not unfair, God is not unjust. And I like how Angelique put it on Twitter. She says that, I think God is just and holy, because in the description of Himself, that He gives us a view of what our choices may lead to. So God tells us before, what if you do this, this is what will happen. If you do this, this is what will happen. And we can't say that we didn't know. She asked, how more just could he be? And I think it's right. When we read the Bible and when we understand, God has clearly said in the Bible, if you do A, you will receive A. And if you do B, you will receive B. So he says, I put before you life and death. You have those options, but please, please, please choose life. Mm-hmm. So I think we just have to remember that, because he restores. And no matter how bad you've been or how many things you've done, God restores. His blood is amazing and it saves. And there's nothing that his blood cannot wash away. Yeah. So we've come to the end of our two lessons, and we're going to go into the Let's Share segment. And thank you guys so much for joining us, Adrienne and Kimberly. And so we're going to go into Let's Share right now. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Pastor Jason Reed.
And I'm Tashatha Jeffrey, and we're the hosts of a show called The God Stop that airs on the East Caribbean Conference's website every Friday night at 7 p.m.
The Bible tells us in Galatians chapter 6 and verse 2 that we are to bear one another's burdens. And today we come with a very special initiative to help our brother bear his burden.
We're coming to you on behalf of Naomi, Kirk Applewhite's daughter, who is experiencing a kidney condition called vasicoureteral kidney reflux disease. It is characterized by the formation of cysts on her kidneys, as well as the flow of urine from her bladder to her kidneys is reversed. The condition is very uncomfortable, and it's something that I believe no child should ever have to live with.
We're here to ask you, yes, to offer your prayers on behalf of this little girl and the family, but we're also asking you to make some financial contributions, because there is a financial burden.
All in all, the cost for the surgery, as well as miscellaneous things such as accommodation, airfare, etc., comes to $40,000. The family is in dire need of funds in order to make sure that little Naomi gets better. So in order to find out more about little Naomi, her family, and her condition, you can visit the website at www.facebook.com/TheNaomiProject, or you can search for The Naomi Project on Facebook to find out how you can help.
The clock is ticking. We hear you.
Oh my, oh my.
We see you.
Hey guys, and welcome to Let's Share,
where we share thoughts,
videos,
ideas,
people,
practical examples,
anything really that we find inspiring
or feel like sharing with you.
I'm Shari.
And I'm Rika. And today we're going to talk to you about trials.
God, you just really be listening to me though? I mean, I just pray every morning. I just study my lesson. I just watch the God Stop every Friday night at 7:15. I feel as though I just do everything just to get your attention, and I don't really see you working in my life. I really don't know if you're listening to me, God. You just listen to me?
Okay, God. I'm trying to understand. I really trying to understand. I mean, my friends married are about to be married. They in careers or have a solid career. And God, I just hate floating in the wind. I don't know what's next for me. What's your plan for me, God?
God, he called me last night. Again. I don't really know if I could do this for much longer, you know. I mean, when Imad called me and he's telling me about all the things he want to do and where he want to take me and all the friends I used to have and the stuff they're doing and all the fun they're having, and the church don't do nothing for me, so I just don't know. It's real hard for me to say no, God. I don't know if I could deal with this temptation for much longer.
Okay, God. I train really, really, really hard. I mean, I'm trying to read the Bible. I'm trying to do the lesson study. I'm trying to go to church. And God, I am trying really, really hard to watch the God Stop on Friday night. And God, I honestly don't believe that the things that I am doing, I should be considering myself a Christian. I do not deserve to be in your church. I do not deserve to be around you or your people. God, I need you.
I hate my life. Sucks. Do you guys ever feel this way?
You ever feel like God isn't listening, or like temptation's coming at you left, right, and center, and you just ain't passing the test?
Right. Or maybe you don't know what God has planned for you, and maybe you feel like you're not fit to be a Christian. You're not worthy.
It happens.
Well, you know what? So do we.
Oh, you were waiting on us to give you something inspiring and uplifting?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We got nothing.
Nothing. Sorry.
So, there's that.
Yeah. But, you know what? We do know someone who has all the answers for when you get discouraged.
He does.
I don't really see you working in my life. I really don't know if you're listening to me. God, you just listen to me.
But God can hear you, and He is listening. Just take some time out. Pay attention and listen to Him. Psalms 34:15 says,
"The eyes of Jehovah are towards the righteous ones, and His ears are toward their cry for help."
God, I just hate floating in the wind. I don't know what's next for me. What's your plan for me, God?
Girl, I know exactly how you feel, and I'm sure some of you out there do too. But Jeremiah 29:11 says,
"For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future."
I just don't know. It's real hard for me to say no, God. I don't know if I could deal with this temptation for much longer.
Let's face it, we're human. It is in our nature to be tempted, and we are not going to win every single battle that comes our way. However, 1 Corinthians 10:13 says,
"There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it."
And God, I honestly don't believe that the things that I am doing, I should be considering myself a Christian.
Yeah, I know. It's really easy to feel unworthy of God's love. But Isaiah 1:18 says,
"Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool." Listen, guys, God can use anything that you're going through right now. Say it with me again. Okay. God can use
anything
that you are going
that
through right
you
now
are going
to make
right
you
now
a better
to
person.
To make you a better person. And you know what? Sometimes we need to be glued to God through our trials, because let's be really honest, we tend to forget about God sometimes. And maybe He takes us through these things so that we can remember to lean on Him, to remember that He is the one who will always be there for us, no matter what. Well, guys, thank you so much for joining us this week on Let's Share,
where we share thoughts,
videos,
ideas,
people,
practical examples,
anything really that we find inspiring
or feel like sharing with you.
I'm Shari.
And I'm Rika.
Bye! For even more Let's Share, join us every Friday night on The God Stop
at 7:15 p.m. at www.eastcarib.org.
Rika, do we look stingy?
We're not stingy.
I don't think we're stingy. Guys, if you have a video or anything you want to share, a quote, anything, please feel free to share it with us.
You can share with us on Twitter, Facebook, or Skype at The God Stop.
But God demonstrates His own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by His blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through Him. The word justified means that you and I stand before God acceptable, spotless, pure, and without sin. That God looks at us and says, there is no sin in that man. There is no sin in that woman. That He looks at us and we are now just in His sight. So all the blasphemy that we've done by choosing stuff over God, all the blasphemy that we've lived in by saying my way is better than God, all the blatant sin of saying creation is better than God is removed, and God sees us as just. Much more then, having now been justified by His blood. This is great news. Nothing about your effort in that test at all. Nothing about your might, your religious stamina, your morality, your cleaning yourself up. You have been justified by an act of God. Bottom line, you have not earned right standing in front of God by your effort or your cleaning up of your life. We have been made pure, standing blameless in front of God, not because of any kind of religious or moral pursuit, but because Christ died. And in his death, he absorbed all of God's wrath for you and I. And that's why the Bible says that for the children of God, we are not appointed to suffer wrath. Because the wrath bestowed upon you and I was absorbed by Christ's death.
Good evening. Welcome back to the God Stop.
Say it after me. God can use.
God can use.
Anything that you're going through.
That you're going through right now.
To make you.
To make you.
A better person.
A better person. Pastor Reed learned something from Let's Share, y'all. I'm proud of you.
You didn't learn?
Proud of you.
I learned. I am happy that I learned.
Me too.
You don't seem that you.
I learned.
Okay.
I just, you know, I wasn't that eager to share that I learned it. You know.
So next. What was the Cornerstone?
Cornerstone was good, Pastor Reed.
I was a little car like.
Yeah. It was all right, Pastor Reed. We don't have to talk about that. But drawing off of the fact that Pastor Reed.
No, I car like. That's like.
Was not here for a part of the Cornerstone. I'm not going to tell out everything. That brings me into the fact that we are having a road trip. We're having another road trip. Yes,
okay.
At Moriah Church. It is. I am told it is the southernmost church in Barbados, which means that, you know, that's cool because it's the southernmost church. And it's beginning at 7:15, begins at 7, sorry. And we are going to have expressions, mission praise, and more. We're going to have singing. We're going to have testimonies. We're going to have the discussion just as normal. We're still going to have our I Praise segments, drama. There's going to be so much stuff, you guys. It is fun. Packed. There's
next
a
week.
Plethora of stuff. Next week,
okay.
April 26th, 7 o'clock at the Meyer Church in the South, Christchurch.
Next week.
So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna have them put where it is on Facebook because
and that is next
week. I'm not too sure. Right, that's next week. So you can check Facebook this week and we'll put the directions or a Google map or something because I don't know where it is. So yeah, okay.
So tell me about the Cornerstone.
So we had a really good lesson. The Cornerstone spoke about the fact that Jesus heals a man by the pool of Bethsaida. Mm-hmm. He healed him on a Sabbath. And Jesus asked an interesting question. He asked whether he wanted to be healed. And we came to the conclusion that sometimes we want to wallow in our problems and we don't want to give the control over to God because at this moment in my life, I just want to be sad and I just want to have a pity party. And God, if you take over, you will make me happy and I don't want to be happy. Yeah. But we have to give God that control because he wants the best for us. Yeah. God restores.
And even in that, the guy also, he said that he had no one to put him in. Some of you like to blame people for the reason why we are in situations. He said, I have nobody, Lord, to put me into the pool. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And we like to blame people. I'm not good because of my upbringing or my mother was poor. Or, you understand? Yeah. So all those dynamics. And then we would have moved on to the Cornerstone to me, which is
to the adult.
Very well. The adult, very sobering and car-like lesson. I think, as a church, whom we always say we are living in the last days, we need to be more serious about what we do. Mm-hmm. Christianity should be more to us than just forms and just things we do because it's announced to be done.
Yeah.
And you just come to church because if you don't come, somebody will call you and humbug you. You know what I mean?
Yes.
I hope it happens or somebody calls you and humbug you. Or you just do things because it's been doing it for years. You don't know why you're doing it. You don't really get the benefit out of it.
Yeah.
But God wants, as Joel is saying, a repentance that is wholehearted,
mm-hmm.
and it's mournful, that is, and it's filled with fasting, that you're really concentrating. You want God really, really badly.
That's true. And so you may be thinking, okay, so you're telling me not to dwell on my problems, and you're also telling me that I have to be sincere. And how do I do that? I've tried and it doesn't work. But the I Prayed segment just melded right into what we were talking about. His strength is perfect.
Yeah.
We don't have to worry about trying to do it in our own human, pitiful strength. God's strength is perfect.
When all strength is
when
gone.
When our strength is gone. True. Even when we have a smidge of our strength doesn't matter. God's strength is perfect. And then let's share.
Yeah.
God, we have our trials.
And we can do that nicely.
Yes. God can use. God can use.
Anything that you're going through.
Anything that you're going through.
Right now.
Right now.
To make you.
To make you.
A better person.
A better person. So just remember that for the week. Yeah. Thank you guys so much for joining us. Thank you to everyone that tweeted us. Thank you to everyone that sent us messages on Facebook. Thank you to all of those in the chat room. Yeah, just remind you guys that the chat room is available. And if there are any questions that you posted in the chat room that we did not discuss on the show, you are free to post them on our Facebook page. And throughout the week, we will get to them. Just make sure that everyone remembers that, you know, we all have our own opinions. But at the end of the day, we all love God and we're all working towards the same goal. Being with him for eternity in heaven. So thank you for joining us on the God Stop. I'm Trishatha Jeffrey.
And I'm Pastor Jason Reed.
Thanks for joining us once again as we stop and wait for God to take us wherever he wants us to go. Have a good evening, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, I gotta get out of here.